Okay. So, greetings to everyone. Welcome to yet another session of the IxDA session. Okay, so tonight we will actually be having a chat with Aditi. So just before that, I think let's give some round of applause to actually District 6 for sponsoring the venue here. It's a very nice whole space. So Alicia, would you like to share a little bit about what is District 6 about?
Hello everybody, I'm Alessia, the General Manager of District 6. I will take just 2 minutes of your time. I know that you're here to listen to the speech and not to me. So District 6 is a newly opened co-working space here. So we are focused mainly on, let's say, try to match the traditional industries with technology. We found that many industries, especially the traditional one like real estate and hospitality, are very traditional yet. So we'd like to match this kind of industries with new startups, like let's say prop tech startups, travel tech startups, and design. So we are super glad to host you here tonight, and I'm super curious to listen to the speech. So I won't take more of your time. If you'd like to know more about District 6, just ping me. I'll be around all the night. So have fun.
Thank you, Lisa. There's a free day pass. So you guys can pick it up if you like to just get out from the whole space and go here. Next thing, how is the food and drink? Pretty nice, right? So thanks to GetLinks who actually sponsored all this wonderful snacks. So the guys from GetLinks are not here, but I'm just gonna like share what they do. So they connect qualified developers, designers, and digital marketers with hundreds of new career opportunities every week, right, through a two-way marketplace. So to wondering what the hell is a two-way marketplace, so just check out their site there. Anyone looking for jobs? I'll give it a try, right? So a sign up link there. Okay, so let's get started. Aditi, take the hot seat.
Went straight into research and UX, and then that brought me to startups. So yeah, right now I'm the head of design at ReferralCandy, which is a startup in Singapore.
So I think not everyone is familiar about what ReferralCandy is.
Yeah. So if you go to the next slide. Okay, so ReferralCandy is an automated service that installs a referral program on any online store. It's super easy to use. You can install it instantly. And we also have another product called Candy Bar. This is a brand new product which we actually just launched yesterday, which is a digital loyalty program for small and medium businesses. So I guess our big vision is we try to make products and services for small and medium retailers, trying to basically help them become more successful, trying to get them to become more digital, and all of that. So these are the two main products that we have.
And how big is your team, and who is in the team?
So our design team is pretty small. We are just four of us, including me. And totally we are about 15 of us. So we have 8 engineers, 8 to 10 engineers, and 4 marketing people, and then 4 designers. We also have a 15-person team in the Philippines who are our customer support team. So that's pretty much it. It's a small team, everybody works on the product. Everybody's hands-on on the product, which is typical of startup.
And when you take on the role, what was the state of the startup when you took on the role?
It was doing pretty well.
Okay.
So,
how about the design team? Is it already established or is it?
I think when I initially joined, one of the most important parts of my role was to establish like design sprints and to get basically our design process more integrated with engineering, sometimes that ends up happening sort of naturally, and then you have to do a lot of sort of deliberate work to ensure that designers and engineers are sort of working really well together and collaborating really well together. So that's a really important part of my role right now. And of course, working on Candy Bar, which is a brand new product, was super challenging. We had to build a team for that. It's still a really new product, so a lot of our energy goes into that. So we're designing it almost every day.
So like 4 designers and what, 8 engineers more. So for this particular Candy Bar, how is the process like? You could share like how is the sprints, the structure and all.
So that's very interesting. We do a lot of user research. We have about, 10 to 12 retailers who are our sort of beta retailers. They are like a special group of people who use Candy Bar since the beginning. And they've seen the product evolve, so they really support us in building the product. So it's a very user-centered process. And we go straight from research into prototyping, releasing something within 2-3 days, back to the user, seeing whether it's working, and then keep trying. So for example, in the last 4 months, we've redesigned the product like 4 times from scratch, because it's a really fast-paced thing where you don't have time to like make wireframes and then do visual design and the sort of typical design process. You have to jump straight from insights to building your product.
And because, I'm also working with like some startups, and the common challenge is always, hey, I have this idea of this new feature, right? So let's launch it, let's put it in our product. But how does this go about in the product?
So right now, I think what happens is the user is king in that, a feature may sound cool, but if it doesn't work, if it's not used, then we know it's actually a failure, right? So I think usage and engagement is very important. So metrics are really important, and we measure everything. So you may make a really cool bet saying that this feature is going to solve all our problems, but the moment it's actually out in the real world and you can actually see, is anyone using it, is anyone actually paying for this product, that's the real validation, and that's when you know whether that's good to work on.
So you talk about measuring, right, and data. So is it just quantitative data that you measure, or?
I think one really good service is called Full Story. where you can do both the quantitative and qualitative measurements. So you can actually watch sessions of people using your product in real life. And then we also have quantitative data. I think we also do a lot of usability testing, like going to the retailer shops and seeing how it's being used and talking to people. So you have to sort of balance both those things, the quantitative and the qualitative.
So just for your info, right, is that usually the first half of the session is about building context. So which is why I'm like constantly asking questions, because I wanted to give you guys a context about her background and what she does in the startup. So I'm going to give you an idea about what she asked about. So back to the team, right? So when you went in, there was only four designers or three other designers.
There were two designers initially, and then we grew the team to four.
Okay,
yeah.
So there was a hiring process.
Yeah.
So we're talking about hiring. So I believe you were involved in hiring.
Yeah.
How long did you sort of like
take? I think hiring is very difficult, but I think it's difficult for everyone. I think one way to make hiring easier, especially for design, is to, you know, like what I'm doing, talk about the work that you're doing in your company. That naturally attracts the kind of designers who want to do that work. So write about it, talk about it, do whatever you can to like propagate that, okay, we are doing really interesting work. The other thing, of course, is networking, like talk to as many people as you can to find the right kind of talent. But yeah, that's it's pretty much, you have to do the work for hiring.
And like, I believe there are quite a bit of people who are new enter the industry.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you look out for when it comes to hiring them?
That's super interesting. I mean, I think in startup, nobody really cares what degree you have. Like, you know, we have an ex-lawyer who is an engineer right now in our team. You know, so it really doesn't matter. It's more about, you know, are you really interested in this role? Is this something you really want to do? And then you can always learn the skills on the job, you know. So that's something that I look for personally. Is this person truly interested in tech, in digital? And then that's, you know, half of it. The other half is actually learning the skills, which is actually not that hard. So yeah, I just look for that interest. Also, if somebody, you know, is truly interested, they should have a website, they should have something to show or to prove that they're truly interested rather than just looking for a job. So that's usually a good indicator of, are these people really into the skills or are they just saying that they're into the skills? That's another thing I look for. Some people are so excited, they want to show you this prototype that they made. It doesn't matter how good it is, it's just, oh, yeah, that person is truly excited about what they do. That's always something to look for. Yeah, you can always tell, you know, if somebody's like really excited about some app that they downloaded, you can just tell, okay, this person really likes this topic, you know, and that's something that I look for always.
So, I went to your previous talk and I understood you made quite a bit of career jumps, but they are all in the design field, so you want to ask a bit more.
Sure, I actually have some slides. Oh, this is Joelle, who's one of our users of Canva. I think I always like to stress with people who use your product. But yeah, this is some of my graphic design work initially. I worked in a leather bag factory for a year and a half, a long time back. I ended up doing the interiors of the stores, which is this. I used to do logo design. So this is an example of a conference branding that I did. I also did a lot of research in India, in small towns and villages in India. I mean, Indian context, small, I don't think we consider it small in Singapore. I, many years ago, worked in arranged marriage websites. And
anyone need arranged marriage?
I didn't do the design of this page.
It was a research role.
Yeah, it was purely research roles, so I took a break from design to become a researcher for a year and a half to, I guess, learn more about user research. I did a lot of apps, you know, a lot of the apps were featured on the App Store and all of that in those days. I worked on, I guess, a lot of projects in fintech across industries and stuff like that. So, I guess to answer your question, yeah, I have jumped around a lot in various industries within design. I literally tried everything that I could at that point just to find what I like to work on.
Okay. I'm curious about the leather bank. What do you do then in the leather bank, actually?
So this is actually really interesting. That's a picture of an auntie who actually makes the bags, like all the factory workers were women. And what I did was, I was initially hired as a graphic designer. I ended up doing like anything that was around. In those days, Facebook pages were very new. So I convinced the CEO to start a social media profile and open the Facebook page. And then eventually, I always went back to digital. Even though my job was to do the graphic design of their price tags and brochures and stuff like that. That was my official role.
Right.
And then we ended up redesigning their online store. A lot of interesting stuff. They also own some restaurants, so I redesigned their menu. I mean, just random stuff that I want. And then something very interesting was they made these bronze cubes for their stores. And it was through a really ancient process called sandblasting. So we used to sandblast the bronze cube. So I had to get all of this meat at the factory. And it was a really super interesting experience. Of course, the opposite of digital, but still very interesting and very exciting. I did a lot of ops work actually in this role because they had about 100 stores across the country. And I had to fabricate these cubes and then send them to each and every store, and it had to reach on time. So I had a lot of like marketing managers after me, like where are my interior fixtures for my store. It was super interesting, and I just sort of took up whatever I felt like at that time. It was nice, and it gave me that opportunity to try it out. So it's an interesting role. I didn't last very long. I think that was 8 months on the job.
Wow, 8 months on the job. And on the user research one, which you were on for like 1.5 years, right? So, I mean, like, who is doing like field research on the ground or user research on the board here? Anyone? Talking to users, Esther, quite a few.
A couple of people,
right? So, I mean, I have not done any research in India, right? But of course, in Singapore, yes, with tourists or whatever. I'm really curious, like, how different is it?
It's very different.
And really, one of the things that we should be looking out for, like, you know, if we are being asked, okay, go to India and do a few research study.
I think what's important is you have to have a lot of sensibility to, you know, whether the person is a man or a woman. So, like, most women do not want to be interviewed by a man, so you always have to go, you know, as to get like two people, and then depending on who you're interviewing, you have to switch around. In some of the small towns, we have to cover our heads and be very sort of sensitive to the community. This was you know, a 6 month long research project for Nokia and stuff like that.
So, oh, okay.
Yeah, in those days.
Okay.
Telecom companies and Nokia to understand how do people in small towns use internet, and we were basically just getting high level insights, you know, how do people use their phones to get internet because they can't afford to buy computers. So what their sort of user flow is like, and you know, they have to go to cyber cafes. Why did they go to cyber cafes? What at what time? And how did that happen? You know, so it was just more like, almost like mini ethnography, like trying to understand the context. Super interesting work, but also frustrating because at the end of the project, you make a deck. I and then you just hand over the deck. And then the designers get a deck and you don't know what they're going to do with it. So it was a learning experience because for the first time I was not a designer and I didn't have control over what was going to happen. So as a researcher, you just, all you can do is try to communicate as much as you can what you learned and then hope that it lasts down the line as it goes from design to development to production. So that was interesting and I learned a lot about software development. If it takes really long,
this kind
of thing that happens
sometimes. So, like, I mean, for preparation for like this kind of role where you didn't actually have any research background, right? Like, were you doing research or?
So, this was at a company called
EdgeFi,
and they sent us for 6 months training. Okay. And then we trained in how to do interviews, how to ask questions. It was very intense. How to do persuasive interviews. It's almost like a therapy session where you speak to someone for 2 hours and really dig deep into why you do what you do and stuff like that. So we were trained beforehand. Most of the team was psychologists and stuff like that. I think I was the only designer, which is interesting. And then everybody sort of got converted into, you know, the technical role was human factors specialist. UX was not really that famous.
So that was your title back then?
Yes. When, human factors.
Just give us a time context. You know, when is that? 90s?
No, I don't know that old.
Wait,
this
sorry.
Is the... I think this is about 7 years ago.
Okay.
I think UX was definitely a term and I was very obsessed with it at the time, but it was still a time when you had to explain what is the full form of UX. UX means user experience, and in every meeting you had to have a slide between so that clients understand what
UX is.
Yes, because otherwise they would complain that you're using acronyms which you don't understand. So yeah, but now of course it's a really great time to be in UX. Everybody knows or is comfortable with them.
So I mean, with so many shifts in your career and going through different phases of your work as a designer. Here's the big question. So, what do you think is your biggest failure?
Oh yeah, we were just discussing this. So, I think one way to answer that is that, you know, I think it has been a continuous series of disappointments and stumbles. If you really look at the whole sort of all of the projects and everything that we work on, that I've worked on over the years, there's always something that doesn't go right. I think my first few jobs were very frustrating for me as a new designer in the industry because I was always like, this isn't good enough, and then I would get to go to another job. So definitely the first few years were really trying for me, but I was trying to find the right fit. There's no real big failure. I think the one thing that stands out is when I didn't get into the college I wanted to get into. So I first, I've always gone into every school that I've ever wanted to in my whole life, and then when I did my master's, I didn't get into my first choice, which was UC at the time, and it really crushed me, and I was like, oh, does this mean I'm not a good designer? And I still got into a really good school, and I still did my master's, and I still got a scholarship, but it stands out because, you know, I was younger, and it felt like a big failure at the time. So that stands out. Other than that, I think nothing has really been that much of a blow after that. It's been pretty, I wouldn't call it smooth sailing, very difficult sailing, but it's been a good road after that.
And how about like success?
I think that depends on what you mean by success. If you mean, you know, projects where, you know, the products were funded really well, or they were featured on the App Store, or all of that. There's so many, you know. But I think one thing that I'm really proud of is this project, which is a conference. I really enjoyed working on it as a designer, and I'm sort of really proud of the work because it's still alive today, and it's still an event that's happening today, every year in India, which is good. Another project that I personally really love is this one. It's a this is just a wireframe, but it's a hospital project that I worked on in India, and they still use this app that we made for them like 4 years ago, which I feel really proud of. And it was an app to help the doctors and nurses do tests more easily and stuff like that. So it took us 1.5 years to build this, but they still use it, which I find to be a good success. And then of course there's this project which I did while I was in an agency, but the clients were super happy, so they made a cake out of it, which I feel like, okay, that's a success. I guess, you know, again, it depends if the client is happy with the success or only if they make money. There's Postman. Postman did really well. They got a bunch of funding and they built a lot of apps, across various platforms. We end up hitting like 4 or 5 million users in like a year, so it was a good rush and it was super fun. There's like a bunch of work that did well. But personally, as a designer, I like the ones that I had fun with more.
So I have a little question about a little bit late to the later on.
Okay.
Any questions from the floor?
Any questions?
You can tell me.
Just to show you have a key number three in the and you have a key number three in the so what that key is going to do, what that can go on with the
Sorry?
For you, this referral candy, you have a key number three.
Uh-huh.
It's like you have to put an engineer's business as well.
Yes.
And then you do outsourcing of the work.
They're part of our team. I wouldn't call it outsourcing, but they are the customer support team. So we also have 2 engineers there, and they are basically the customer support team based in the Philippines. So they have a different function.
So you still have part
of course, yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
You just mentioned that you worked in. So you just mentioned you worked in a design agency as well as now you're working in a startup.
Yeah.
Right. So the question is that how does your process differ while working in a design agency where you have probably freedom to actually go through the whole process from user stories, wireframes, to actual UI, as opposed to startup, which is where you need to do things with the idea. You just mentioned if you have a directly go to the US. So how do you differ and which would you really prefer?
I think it's very clear which one I prefer. Obviously I prefer product and startup. But I think it's every designer has their own preference. I think the main difference is like I was saying, in agency you try to make the client happy, and no matter how much you try to care about the users, you are incentivized to make the client happy. And I enjoyed it when I was doing it. And my aim was to make the client happy. And I was in charge of accounts. I was creative director. So part of the role is to perform for the client and to keep them, in this sort of happy state. So I think that's sometimes very different from startup, where everybody is aligned on the same exact goal, which is, hey, we need to make a better product for our customers so that we are also better off. So it's a very different way of working, and it's also a different way of I think in agencies the way that the contracts are structured are hourly. You're being paid hourly, and all of that also affects how you work as a designer. So if I am being, if my time is going to be like $200 an hour, and that's how it's structured, then maybe we are incentivized to spend longer doing the project. I know that sounds terrible, but sometimes it happens. So I think with startups, that can just never happen. You do want to finish. You are only doing user research and for one goal, which is making a better product. The other thing at agency was we tried to do product accelerators. There are many sort of hybrid structures which actually do really well. So you could try that too. I did quite a few product accelerators which made me realize that, hey, this is amazing and we should do more product. So yeah, I think it just depends what kind of designer you are and how you want to do, what you want to try at that time. The great thing about consultancy is you can try so many different kinds of projects. In like 4 months, you can do, you know, 4 different apps and try so many things. So that's also an advantage of doing a consultancy together.
So like for someone who is new, right? I encountered this before. So like, do you recommend them to go into an agency or like a startup or product or like a
I guess I'm very biased, so I would always say startup and product. But again, it's up to you as a designer. I think that you should choose whatever you want to do and then just try that. There's no harm trying something for a few months to see if it works, and then if it doesn't work, try something else. I think a lot of designers who are new to the industry feel the pressure for their career to make sense, but don't feel that pressure. I remember even I left Postman, a lot of people gave me advice that, oh, you are in the API industry, so now you have to join developer tool product. And I was like, what? Okay. So it's very interesting. I think some people feel that there has to be this narrative that I'm here and so my next step has to be here, but actually you should just do whatever it excites you and whatever interests you, and then have fun here.
So we have some agency folks here, right? Oh, you're from agency as well. Right. So, I mean, what do you all think about the differences in the process between a product and a startup? Like, I mean, in a product environment and agency environment.
Right, that's what my question exactly was. So, that was exactly the question. So, in agency, you have to follow a detailed process, right? So, you said that in startup, you have to quickly go to work. So, does that mean that the whole process is kind of redundant? Or,
I don't think the process is redundant. I think it's good to have a really good design process, and I really like the structured design process that happens in agency, but you have to know when to break the rules. And I think the problem is too much documentation. Like when you have to make decks for everything, it's like a waste of time for everyone. When everyone was there and everyone knows what the insights were, why make a deck? Because there's no client to give the deck to. Right, so you're sort of trapped in this circle of documentation, and you have to make a 80 slide deck about all the wireframes. Then you have to make a 100 slide deck for the visual design. That doesn't happen. We still follow process, of course. We still do research, we still have insights, but it's more free flowing because you're not trapped in that deliverable sort of setup. You know, that's I think another difference between being in product and being in a consultancy setup.
You said that you were brought out to the product design sprints in the current role. How can you share, just an example, if there's anything that you do different given the pace at which you turn out and stuff? You know, just as an example of what you just said.
I guess it's both design and engineering working together in a product sprint. So usually what happens is that a designer and engineer pair up together and then choose something to work on, and then work on that thing. We have 2 weeks sprints, but you can choose what kind of sprint you want. And then over those 2 weeks, the designer and engineer collaborate, build out various things, push to production, see if it's working, and all of that. So it just depends on what they're working on. It could be a really small change, it could be a really big change. But they usually have a goal. So for example, the goal would be, why don't both of you work on, increasing sign-up conversion by 10%, just as an example. And then at the end of the sprint, we would check, okay, guys successful and what are you guys wrong? So it's a very sort of independent process, I think, where each person has to have ownership over the thing that they are doing. You know, nobody's like on you saying, oh, have you done? I think the other thing is that there's no requirements. It's not like these other list of features that you have to build. It's the two individuals who decide what they're going to build, and then is that actually going to affect the user in the way that you want it to affect the user. So that's like, I guess, the ideal sprint process. The thing with sprints is that every sprint is slightly different. It never repeats itself, and so it's always a learning process. You know, it could go wrong, and then you have a retro and you try to understand what went wrong. And then the next sprint, you change your process. That's the whole point of sprints, that you don't repeat the same mistakes again and again. You keep changing and you keep trying different things.
So before you join ReferralCandy, were there any sprints?
Yes, they were.
So it's kind of like enhancing things.
I think most startups already have sprints. I have rarely seen a startup that doesn't use sprints. You know, most teams, and also ReferralCandy is quite a mature product. You know, ReferralCandy has been around for like 5 years, so they are already pretty good at what they do. You know, I'm just there to like help out. So that's pretty much, yeah.
Yes.
Sorry, because you only have two mics here.
How does research figure out if you're doing the...
Oh, that's a great question. So we don't have what I would call like research phases. We have sort of a continuous research process. It never stops. So we have like insane amounts of data coming in every day. And then it's just like so much data that the designers and engineers always can sort of pick and choose what they want to work on. You know, so sometimes what happens, and I've seen this happen in other teams, is that you decide to do research for the team and then you plan it that next 2 weeks we'll do research. We don't do that. We do continuous research. We have calls with people, even if there's like no pressing need to find out anything, because it's always useful to talk to people who are using a product. Just 2 days ago, I went downstairs in Blocks Everyone, and I met Panel Place, which is this new startup that's just moved in. And they were interested in ReferralCandy, so I just went and spoke to them. That's research too. It doesn't have to be like initiated all the time. So because of the continuous process, we have almost too much data, like more than what we know what to do.
Hi. So, given the amount of data that you get from your research, how do you decide which ones to tackle first?
That's a good question. I think usually we do have sort of, I guess sometimes it's called the North Star metric. So for ReferralCandy, it's referral revenue. So we want our retailers to have more and more referral revenue. And so anything that's going to directly impact that gets prioritized. You know, and then also if anything is like truly effective, like if we make a change and we see that, hey, that's really effective, then we do more of that. You know, so it's again, that's why sprints are really helpful, because you can keep learning based on what's working and what's not working, and then change what you're doing. But of course, product prioritization is really hard, and you can't always get it right. So we keep trying to get it right. That's really the best.
Ultimately, you focus on the bottom line.
I think revenue is definitely like the most user-centric metric that we can choose, because if our retailers are more successful, that's great. You know, for them, and that's our goal. And that's for ReferralCandy. And for Candy Bar, it can be like repeat customers, because we want more loyal customers to come in. And so, any, you know, new feature or new update that's going to directly impact that will be first. You know, and then everything else follows.
Okay, thank you. Hi.
Hi.
I like to hear about more of the usability testing or the use. Then you directly go to the person who talk to the person. maybe you just look out for audience, targeted audience, for a specific person can do that. What is the case of like the matrimonial side, or the hospitality, or the banking, or whatever you can
yeah.
with a larger audience? So is that any structured way out for doing this?
I think there's a lot of methodologies out there, you know, ways of doing user research and usability testing. And I think it really depends on how much time you have, you know, and how, what it basically, it's just how much time you have and how much money you have to spend on the research. So, with the example of banking, a lot of fintech, they tend to, you know, have deeper pockets and you can do more extensive research in the consultancy setting. There are many various methods like card sorting, depending on the kind of thing you're trying to find out.
Card sorting, I answer money, answer methods, it's kind of a grouping element on
yes.
it's like a how the user perceives the arrangement of the arrangements of certain users.
Mm-hmm.
But what else is actually example in analytics and project, some product or services. And how do you actually feel about your services or the product? Is that anything else that actually need? What you do in sometimes may not need. So how do you make the pulse of the audience through your under feature or is that any other structured mechanism to get the users off?
I think you need to do continuous research. You know, it's not like you can get one clean answer like that. You know, humans are complicated. So it's not like if you do usability testing, suddenly you have the answer to everything and you know what to do. It can only tell you some insights, and at some point you do have to make a leap of intuition and do the design, right? The testing can only tell you the area which you have to work in, and then the designer has to pick up from there and try various experiments and see which experiments. So
okay,
hello.
Yeah. Sorry, we need to pass around the mic.
We can talk more often.
Yeah, we can. Yeah, definitely. Yes.
I think that's a great question. I think one example that I personally faced is at Postman, where we built this feature called code generation, and the engineering team spent 4 months building it, so you know it's a lot of resources. But then when we released it, it didn't do really well, as you said. And then I think what's required is that the quantitative numbers can only tell you that something is wrong. They won't tell you why it's wrong or how it's wrong. You have to, that's why qualitative data is really, really important. Then you have to actually go in and investigate the issue from either user research point of view or designer point of view or product point of view. So there's something happening there, but you just can't see it because the numbers just show a dip, right? So when I looked into it, I found out that it was because the button that launches the feature was an icon and nobody understood what the icon was. Again, that was my hypothesis when I saw it. And then on that day, I was like, let's just change it to a text thing which says code generation. It looks bad, but at least it's readable. And the icon was too abstract anyway. So we changed it, and within a day, people started tweeting at us that, hey, this is a really cool new feature that I have, that we have in Postman. So this is the sort of instant feedback that you get in product. Within a day or two, you know whether the thing that you did worked or didn't work. If there's silence, then you know that nobody cared. So, that's the sort of advantage of working in a product or a startup. You instantly know as a designer, does this design work? It may look really awesome, but no, it didn't work. So, even for my designer at the time, it was a really big process because he was stressing out about, oh, my icon isn't good enough. But it's not that. It's just, you know, it's really hard to make an icon which would work across like 4 million people and everybody would get it, you know. So it's okay to make that call at that time to see. So yeah, it's a combination of both qualitative and quantitative. Quantitative is really nice in that it points you in the direction, but it won't really tell you how to solve it.
Yes.
Can you repeat that?
How do you think about your false quality and your true quality? Since most of your data that you see for you, that is, you will see sample of each and what sort of data.
I think, you know, it's just a trial and error process because we are a small team. You know, each person is looking at the data. You know, there are 4 or 5 of us that are continuously looking at the data and we have to keep checking against the reality of the situation. Is this real? And because obviously there's always a chance that what you're looking at is not right, like as you said. So you have to keep checking. I think one thing that helps us is the qualitative data, because if something is wrong on either side, then you can keep checking across. And I think the customer support team really helps me personally because they are 15 people and they really know the product and they're damn good at it. And anytime I feel like I have a doubt, I can just check with them. Like, hey, am I like thinking the right thing? Because they're continuously talking to customers, so they really know the sort of latest on what you're looking at. So,
So I think we want to move our attention a bit to the other side of you,
okay,
which is the installation bit.
Okay.
Right. How do you end up in like doing interactive installation?
Okay, so I did my master's in the UK and I was supposed to do an interactive media course, but I ended up doing a bit of a fine arts course there. And I just decided to do installations there. My teachers there were very encouraging. And they told me it didn't matter what my project was, and yeah, so I still got my interactive media degree, but my actual project was fine arts, and that's when I think it was like a great way to combine art and technology in a way that was enjoyable to me. And the thing about art is that you can just do whatever you want. There's no client, and you don't have to justify what you're doing. So it was super interesting and I was really lucky. A couple of galleries in the UK picked up my work, and then when I came back to India, a couple of galleries in India also picked up my work. But the art world is really different and scary, so I haven't really spent a lot of time.
Do you follow him?
I don't know. Let me check. Yeah. So this is some neon work that I did in the UK. Yeah, and then this is an installation that I did in Bombay. It's pretty huge. I don't think you can see the scale here, but it's like, you know, 7 feet wide, and it's in an abandoned factory in Bombay. And it was super exciting because this little kid on the left hand side, she was super excited about it. It was the first time she was seeing an interactive installation. And again, I just really enjoyed doing something like this for the community in Bombay, which is where I'm from. And all of my work is about the city, so yeah.
So she could actually interact with you.
Yeah. Basically, this one is where you sit in the space, and then in your shadow, you see another sort of little plane, and then as you move, it sort of moves with you. So something like that, a lot of these kids haven't ever seen, and they were very excited about it. So this was a huge art event in Bombay with like 100 artists. So it was really nice to actually meet the community. I think I really like the community too. So yeah, this was just something I tried out because I had the opportunity to try it out.
For yourself as a designer, how do you sort of like keep up with all the new things that are ongoing right now?
I think I depend a lot on people that I talk to in the industry. I have a lot of friends in the startup world. to all three cities anytime and find out what's the latest. I do read a lot, but I think that sometimes the things that you can learn from talking to people are at a completely different level. You learn things about companies that people would never write about. Yeah, so you really find out what's happening and what's the latest stuff.
Any other questions from this question?
Understanding you as a designer, understanding their experience. needed as a design?
Not at all. I think that one way, what I was saying earlier, which is one way to earn that trust, is to show that design can instantly impact the product, right? And no developer is going to fight with you if they find out that, hey, my feature that I built is really doing well out there because of the design that we built. So it's more about understanding that we're all on the same team. There shouldn't be that design versus engineering mindset. That's what, you know, that's really damaging to the team. So if everybody's on the same team, then it's easier to resolve. I really, really believe that most developers really want to build really awesome things. So it's easy to work with them. Well, I think you should spend some effort understanding the limitations. And I think learn a little bit of code and understand the material that you're working with. So, for example, an architect would understand material, right? You need to understand what are the different kinds of material, what is the building made of, how much weight can it carry. So similarly, as a designer, you have to understand the basics of code. You have to be able to talk to a senior architect and understand what the hell they're saying. Because if you can't, then it's like trying to build a building and make it look cool, but then the whole thing will fall apart because there's no like proper, I don't know, road bearing or something. So you have to understand the material you're working with. And if the developer feels that you don't care, that's the beginning of the mistrust.
So you learn designing first, and you started your career in design.
Yes, I am very much a designer.
And then you started learning developers, how they do it. Then you modify your design thinking, terms and language of stuff.
Definitely, I think, you know, it's like when you work with marketing people, you need to try and understand where they are coming from. Everybody has their deep specialization, but as UX, we have to be collaborators. And so we have to take that extra effort to understand everyone and sort of bring it all together. So, yeah, it's very important.
It's the same analogy as a little comment that you went on the previous one. So Chewy from BDS was saying, yeah, the designers are in the middle. One hand we are working in product people, product managers, and the other hand we are working in the engineers and developers. We have both hands as well.
Yeah, everybody needs to get along.
So, if you are not a designer today, what will you do?
Oh wow, I think maybe
I'll
be an artist, but I'm not sure if I would be a very successful artist. So be a struggling artist or maybe a pilot. At some point as a child, I wanted to be a pilot.
Wow.
It's random, I know. That's all.
And do you have someone that you follow or admire?
I think as a graphic designer, I had design heroes like Sam Meister and Jessica Walsh. And Peter Bilak, I don't know how many of you have heard of him, he's in the top of the world. But from a UX point of view, I don't really have any design heroes that stand out. I think I follow a lot of people on Twitter and LinkedIn, and I know a lot of really great designers. I think it's rarer for a UX person to be like a hero. It's usually like a team effort. There is an app that I really admire called IA Writer. I really love that, and I think that's like one of the most... I think IA Writer is one of the most sort of beautiful examples of sort of perfect interaction design. It's just amazing. They even... it's done by a very small agency, and it's just a writing app. They even made their own font just for the app. Like, they didn't care. It's a really amazing product. So that's really something that I really sort of admire and look up to.
Okay, so any other questions? Last one from the floor? No? So last one from me actually. So that was a very good question. It has been something that I've been thinking about quite long, because I think as a designer, we are involved in many things. We can do many things, right? Like we'll be doing an installation, we'll be there are so many opportunities that we could be involved in. So, and this ties in with like ethics, like designers, ethics, and how do you choose when is the next move and what kind of work do you want to be in?
I think for me, it's about the people that I work with, rather than how cool or popular the product is. There's always the opportunity to join really, the cool new kid on the block or whatever product or startup. But for me, what's important is to work with really amazing people that you can learn about from. Because that's how you grow as a designer. You know, you can always join the cool product leader or new creator. So I think even my next step would be completely about working with really good people who know like a lot more than me and who I can learn from.
Is that why you shifted from Abu Dhabi to Singapore?
Yeah, I think I like to explore different worlds of design, and I really love Singapore as a city. And yeah, I had the opportunity to work with ReferralCandy, so I grabbed that opportunity when I could.
So thank you so much for this chat. Okay, so here's the end of the session. I think it's a little bit of
thank you.
IxD teacher, S science.
Thank you.
The teachers are also for sale at the back. It's actually used for fundraising because we run all these meetups not for profit, right? For snacks and stuff. So. If you'd like to get one, it's $20 each, so you need to get it back, get one. And I think there's still some time, some snacks left over. Feel free to help us out with it, travel around, put some name tags, right? So see you again when it happens. Good night.
Hey, okay.